morning and welcome to Kitchen Conversations. I'm so glad that you're here. We have an amazing night in store for you tonight. So I'm glad that you're here. So we take this divine breath into the stillness of knowing that right here and right now in this universe, everywhere, the breath of God is breathing, is being, is expressing through each and every one of us. And in this dynamic time of awareness, we focus on the breath. The breath in, Yahweh. The breath out, Yahweh. Yahweh is the blessings of God. It is saying, I recognize the breath of God that is me, and I love this divine presence. So we surround the world in this divine blessing of absolute appreciation for the breath that is in each and every one of us. That's in our family, that's in our friends, for those that are experiencing health issues, for those that are experiencing financial burdens, for those that are experiencing confusion and anger and scarcity and afraid. Right now, we breathe the breath of God into them right now. Yahweh, Yahweh. Knowing that they are surrounded in the love of God. And even though if they cannot see it, we know the truth for each and every one right now.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know.
So anchoring this divine word into all that is, into the absolute, we rest in this very moment. We rest in the breath of God. We rest in this healing place. That every brother and sister, every mother and father, that every child, every animal, every bit of this divine universe is anchored in spirit, is anchored in God. The unsheltered, those dealing with addiction, recovery, abuse, knowing that God is in every facet of this breath that we are breathing, that there is a divine solution for each and every one. Be still and know that the I am that you are, that I am that we all are, is God. That was a beautiful, thank you, Spirit. That just was kept pouring out. I'm glad you're here tonight. And tonight we're going to do a little something different. In Kitchen Conversations, you know, one of the things that we are about is sharing information, creating wisdom, also bringing up triggers that have kept us locked in our old way of thinking so that we can find new avenues of expressing ourselves and new ways of communicating. And so tonight, we are bringing forth a beautiful video. It's about a little plus 30 minutes. So I'm asking you to hang in there with me. And this video will take you chronologically on the road of how Black Lives Matter began. So I am knowing for each of you that it will be a space of wisdom, awareness, insight, and I invite you as you watch this video to stay with us and chat after the video. If you have questions, if you have comments, and you can chat also during as well, but it would be nice to bring you into the fold. Because none of us, not a one of us, is free until we all are free. None of us are free. None of us are free. None of us are free. If one of us in chains, none of us are free. Well, you better listen, my sister and brothers, 'cause if you do, you will hear the voices that are calling across the years. And they're crying across the ocean, and they're crying across the land, and they will until we all understand that none of us are free. None of us are free. None of us are free. If one of us in chains, none of us are free. Oh, there are people in the darkness, and they just can't see the light. If you don't say it's wrong, that says it's right. Oh, we gotta give love to each other. Let our brothers know that we care. Come on, let's send the message out loud and clear that none of us are free. None of us are free. None of us are free. If one of us in chains, none of us are free. None of us are free. None of us are free. Yeah. Don't you know none of us are free if one of us. None of us are free. Mm. So tonight, as we get ready to show you this video, We'll put the link as well in the description so that you can go on YouTube as well and support this wonderful vehicle that they've put together for us to see information about Black Lives Matter. There's been so much talk that it's a terrorist group, that it's anti-government, that just fear conversations about Black Lives Matter. And so I thought tonight would be a fabulous opportunity to come together, join and watch this video and see how it absolutely started. So let's hope. I think we're having a little technical difficulties because I am seeing my social screen. Hopefully you're seeing me. And as we get ready to show the video, I'm hoping that you'll see the video. So let's go to the video. Yes.
Sanford Police Department.
Hey, we've had some break-ins in my neighborhood, and there's a real suspicious guy. This guy looks like he's up to no good, or he's on drugs or something.
Okay, and this guy, is he white, black, or Hispanic?
He looks black.
Did you see what he was wearing?
Yeah, a dark hoodie, like a gray hoodie, and either jeans or sweatpants and white tennis shoes. He's got something in his hands. I don't know what his deal is.
Okay, just let me know if he does anything, okay?
Officer over here.
Yeah, we got him on the way. Just let me know if this guy does anything else.
Okay.
Are you following him?
Yeah.
Okay, we don't need you to do that.
These they always get away. Yeah.
I personally got obsessed with watching the Zimmerman trial. I was at a bar, and I knew that the verdict was due because everything went silent. And that's when we started to check our phones.
Please be seated. I understand that we have a verdict.
Court of the 18th Judicial Circuit in and for Seminole County, Florida, State of Florida versus George Zimmerman. Verdict, we the jury find George Zimmerman not guilty. So say we all, four person.
When I saw that George Zimmerman had been acquitted, I felt like I'd been punched in the gut.
When the George Zimmerman verdict hit, everyone was talking about it. And so you had this loud rise of voices. It almost became the OJ trial of the new century.
Many people were trying to make sense of what happened, but I felt like the ways that people were trying to make sense of what happened and what we needed to be doing about it were actually destructive.
Nobody asked your goddamn opinion. Somebody wants your goddamn opinion.
How do we learn how to organize? How do we learn how to develop a set of demands that will actually transform conditions in our communities? I wrote a letter to Black people on Facebook saying that there was nothing wrong with us and we deserve dignity and respect.
I came across Alicia's post hours later. I understood there's this thing called a hashtag and you can make something go viral. and then I put a hashtag in front of it saying Black Lives Matter.
The moment was electric. Black Lives Matter was a brilliantly framed set of marching orders / slogan / plea. I can't pretend that I saw a movement coming out of this particular moment, but young Black people, they are plugged in and they're moving this conversation. They're driving this conversation.
It was taking off like wildfire, but people are really beginning to ask the question, is this just young people that are playing out on Twitter and in Facebook? Is this legitimate activism or just people using their phone? Is this a moment or a movement?
I did nothing. We sit here the whole time running our business. Every time you see me, you want to mess with me. I'm tired of it. It stops
today. Guy right here is forcibly trying to lock somebody up for breaking up a fight.
Everybody's standing here. They told you I didn't do nothing.
Hold on.
Don't touch me. Don't touch me.
Racist cops on Staten Island. This is what the they do.
The difference between Trayvon Martin and Eric Garner was that here you saw the injustice. There was a video associated with it. So not only did you have this description, you also had a Black man who was there getting wrestled to the ground by police, who is saying, I can't breathe.
There's growing outrage here in New York over the confrontation with police that was caught on cell phone video.
The movement is actually happening and it's connecting the dots. Now we have, instead of the scattered buckshot of Black people talking about things that have happened to them, and it's just word of mouth, now it is a hardcore human movement that is crafty enough to use social media to lift up its voice, to have a serious impact and change the direction of the national conversation.
There are people now with phones watching the police. So it's very, very powerful. We want America to see what is happening. At a certain point, we are going to blow. We are going to blow the door down.
I was getting ready for work, and then I heard the first gunshot. I just knew that someone had got shot on the street, and it was by police. It was such a surreal moment. I was kind of just like tweeting really fast. I remember I had a lot of typos. And then people started seeing it.
It was only a few weeks after Eric Garner when it happened. And so there was something about August 9th in Ferguson that really became a catalyst for the eruption of a national movement.
People wanted not just answers, they wanted justice. Things are raw. You're dealing with a young Black male, unarmed, shot multiple times. And at that point, the story was that he didn't run. He had his hands up. So you already had a lot of emotion surfacing.
To the officer, I pray for you because you shall reap what you
and
have
sown. And we are
the police murdered Mike Brown in the middle of the street, and his body was laying down there for 4 hours. People just wanted justice for this dead black boy, but then the police bringing dogs out, pulling guns out on women and kids. Yeah, that's what took the turn.
I remember seeing elderly people out there and children out there. We were being at home, right? Being in our own streets. And for folks in Ferguson, literally their own streets. But we were treated like... We were treated like we were in a war.
If you are in the middle of the street, you are lawfully assembled. Immediately.
Everything erupted in Ferguson. This is rage. It's profound sadness. And it was all on Twitter.
Social media extended the reach of the activists. It both allowed people in faraway localities to have a minute-by-minute view of what was continuing to happen in Ferguson, and it also meant that activists could communicate immediately about where demonstrations were, where protests were. It just accelerated the rate of activism surrounding this case.
We were out in the streets responding to the needs as they were presented, and in that moment, young people were saying, we're gonna stand up and we're not going home.
I was just there. I wasn't there trying to be the news or be a reporter. I just tweeted everything that I knew to be true. And the next thing you know, like, the police are shooting tear gas. And it was the first time I thought I was gonna die.
Oh, they're coming back.
Go, 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 go.
Ferguson, Missouri is under a state of emergency.
I signed an order declaring a state of emergency.
This is for your safety.
The eyes of the world are watching.
Those visuals impacted my desire to go there, seeing police pulling out, where did you get tanks and full body armor and bazookas and all of this tear gas?
It happened via social media. And you're kind of looking at things and you're kind of like, what just happened? St. Louis is home for me. And I used to live in the same apartment complex where it had happened. So I had to come back for that situation.
We just had a stupid ass cop.
Black his ass up.
And we need to make sure that he pays for what he done.
Ferguson becomes a magnet for activists around the country. The activists who form Black Lives Matter organize a freedom ride to Ferguson, where they bring 500 activists from around the country to demonstrate solidarity.
I was sitting on my couch, it was 1 o'clock in the morning, and I saw the events unfolding on Twitter. And I said, I just want to go. I want to at least bear witness. So I got in the car, drove 9 hours, ended up in St. Louis. The second night that I was in St. Louis was the first night of the curfew. And it was the first night that I got tear gassed. And it was in that moment that I became a protester.
People from the Arab Spring were tweeting to the protesters in Ferguson how to deal with the tear gas. They were coaching them from Arab Springs to Ferguson, making that connection organically. But I thought, oh, snap, this is different. This is different. They're in solidarity, uprising.
It became clear and undeniable that this was more than a few angry people on the street. Without every single person who was out there tweeting and Facebooking and posting pictures and standing in front of those officers in Ferguson, there would be no movement.
Eric Garner was in New York, Trayvon Martin was in Florida. People think these things don't happen in the Midwest. But now this is, in a sense, the epicenter of a national movement.
I bring to you one of the most influential civil rights leaders of our history, Reverend Al Sharpton. America, it's time to deal with policing. We are not the haters, we're the healers. But then let me say this, what does God require? That Michael Brown does not want to be remembered for a riot.
Not at all, not at all.
Sitting around having ghetto pity parties rather than organizing and strategizing. You've lost where you come from.
You know, there's this idea that this was a space created by these young people, that they'd been in the streets, they'd been tear gassed, they had been leading the chants and crafting the signs, and they didn't want older civil rights activists taking what they had created. And I think that that exposed and was one of the first kind of fault lines in what has been a deep ideological split between older Black America and younger Black America.
It was almost like a bat signal had gone off and civil rights had been flashed in the sky, and all of a sudden they rushed like Cape Crusaders to come in and save the day. But this was a very modern movement. People weren't expecting civil rights leaders of a bygone era to stand side by side to these young people who had a voice.
Are you marching today with us, or you just gonna sit in the car?
Because we haven't seen you marching at all, Jesse.
You gonna march, or you gonna sit in the
we
car?
Ain't seen you.
I remember Jesse Jackson showed up and he got yelled down by some of the young activists. This was about defiance. That is the movement.
These protesters took control of the narrative and took it out of the hands of the old guard civil rights establishment. And this was really the first time where people said, no, we're not going to defer to you. We have been successful thus far. So the people of Ferguson are not going away until Darren Wilson, the police officer who shot Mike Brown, is indicted. That is the demand of the movement, is the indictment of Darren Wilson.
We're now talking about what does it mean to have justice? I can remember how different that felt. And it was so tense because we didn't know when the decision was coming.
I think not telling us when the announcement's gonna come is a power play by the state. We are ready though, we've been ready, and we're protesting.
We are about to hear the grand jury decision in the fatal shooting of Michael Brown by Ferguson, Missouri police officer Darren Wilson.
The duty of the grand jury is to separate fact from fiction. They discussed and debated the evidence among themselves before arriving at their collective decision. After their exhaustive review of the evidence, the grand jury deliberated over 2 days, making their final decision. They determined that no probable cause exists to file any charge against Officer Wilson and returned a no true bill on each of the 5 indictments.
We see just the enormity of the problem that the movement is up against. Because for every incidence of police brutality that has been exposed, we still have the fact that Darren Wilson, who killed Mike Brown, was not indicted. Every time people have thought the movement disappeared, it reemerges on the streets. It erupted in an entirely new way in the city of Baltimore in April of 2015.
We've heard about so many victims of police brutality before Trayvon Martin died, before Mike Brown died. We know that the system protects police officers, but I don't think it didn't give everyone permission. It gave everyone purpose.
Well-articulated retaliation. This war has only begun. We are being systematically murdered, and it's being televised. We burn with anger and hunger for justice. We've had enough. We will fight back.
There was a fire started. Pray for my dear departed.
Breaking news coming out of New York City where a grand jury has voted not to indict a police officer who used a chokehold on Eric Garner.
Remarkable scene just unfolded moments ago. Cavs star LeBron James took the court for warm-ups in this t-shirt bearing the words, "I can't breathe." Latest in a series of pro athletes to invoke those words, which have become a rallying cry for nationwide protests against police brutality.
St. Louis Rams players came out with the hands up, don't shoot pose, paying tribute to Michael Brown.
It's an artist's duty to reflect the times in which we live, because the struggle for justice is right now. We want to tell you we are with you, we see you, we love you, and march on. God bless you.
All my life's never needed, deepest and strong. Tell me who's gonna score. We just trying to go harder than we did.
Growing outcry tonight after a routine traffic stop that turned deadly. Father, apparently unarmed, shot as he ran from this police officer.
I am sick and tired of being sick and tired. We need to be out here every week, every month, and every year until this changes.
Should I be mad at you? If I hit the jail, I was just passing through. Numbers smudge on my record, y'all had to do.
Look at Glenn. That boy Glenn. Look at Glenn.
Justice in the enemy. There's a fight now for my life now.
25-year-old Freddie Gray died yesterday, just 1 week after he was rushed to the hospital with spinal injuries by four Baltimore police officers. Gray's family attorney said 80% of the man's spinal cord had been severed near his neck. Baltimore police officials are promising accountability.
Just us, so angry it's just us, so angry it's just us.
Protesters in Baltimore are demanding.
I'm hungry for just us, it's just us. The hatred is killing my soul.
It felt like we was in the civil rights movement. But, you know, when I took that image, I didn't think it was gonna end up on the cover of Time. These are not just random acts of rioting. This is anger. This is the uprising, you know? And that's what it is. They're not thugs. They're soldiers, you know? Like, they're not thugs. These are brothers. These are sisters. These are fathers. These are sons. These are human beings. They're not thugs. They're angry.
Authorities are saying that they want all the protesters off the streets now to prevent a repeat of last night's mayhem, where rioters destroyed 15 buildings, set fire to 150 cars, looted dozens of businesses, and so far there have been over 200 arrests and 20 police officers have in fact been injured. We go right to the ground tonight in Baltimore with the very latest. Our own Geraldo Rivera is there. Geraldo.
Hey, Sean. It's a very excited crowd where I am standing right now. I'm with the state Senate Majority Leader, Pew. Come on, get out of the way, man. Get out of the way.
Don't touch me.
Stop blocking my camera. Stop blocking my camera. You're making a fool of yourself. You're making a fool of yourself.
No, don't walk away. I want you and Fox News to get out of Baltimore City because you're not here reporting about the boarded up homes and the homeless people under MLK. You're not reporting about the poverty levels up and down North Avenue.
I didn't even know who he was. But the first thing I did after that was text my father. I was like, look, I was yelling at someone from the media. So if you see it, don't be mad. When they're reporting about riots, when they're reporting about looting, they aren't reporting about the living conditions or the condition that Penn North was in before the CVS went up into flames.
Everyone can see what's happening. Our villages are broken. So, you know, this Freddie Gray story kind of escalated from people waking up into consciousness to people being fed up. You know, Baltimore has been fed up.
I think Baltimore speaks to a deeper problem about policing in American cities. In fact, 3 of the 6 police officers that picked up Freddie Gray were African American themselves. If people could say that Ferguson could happen because you had a corrupt white government governing over a mostly black population, Baltimore destroys all of that. And I think we have to take into consideration that inequality gives rise to police violence in black communities. So how do you actually go about fighting for justice?
FTP! Police! FTP! Police! FTP! Police! FTP!
Black lives matter.
I think they're a hate group. They hate police officers.
You would think if you have an organized group in America saying we want dead cops, that all decent people would reject that group. You would think, correct?
You know, you're tweeting out that
No one prepares you for backlash. Fox News and Bill O'Reilly in particular have come after us. But where did that narrative come from? That's not coming from our mouths. That's not the shared story we have.
You were able to find one clip of some people who were saying some outrageous things, but that is not a reflection of the entire movement.
Mr. Boykin,
has anybody in the leadership ever said that?
Mr. Boykin,
has
anybody?
Has Dorian McKesson ever said that? Has anyone in the leadership ever said that?
Let's talk about the backlash against Black Lives Matter in some corners of the press. Is it warranted, or is a dangerous connection being made between the movement and a misunderstood message?
Every struggle I've ever been a part of, there are always outliers. There are always occasional folk who show up, who often co-opt or twist the message.
So do you feel that Fox News hosts were seizing on these comments in order to paint with too broad a brush? What do you think happened this week? It seemed like Fox had a narrative very clearly.
The unfortunate thing is this is the Black Lives Matter movement, which can only be described as nonsense, is creating a lot of this type of thing around the country, and it's going to backfire, quite honestly.
They will do everything they can to make sure that they are top of show hitting you with hard headlines. But we have to anticipate it, we have to stop being surprised, because this is real.
Today, the Harris County Sheriff's Office mourns the loss of one of our own. Deputy Darren Goforth was senselessly struck down while pumping gas at a Chevron station in Northwest Harris County yesterday evening.
We've heard Black Lives Matter. Well, cops' lives matter too. So why don't we just drop the qualifier and just say lives matter and take that to the bank?
People are chanting, what do we want dead cops? When do we want them now? I'm not the one saying this. There are people in the Black Lives Matter movement that are saying that we want to go out and we want
to... Are you suggesting that a chant from Minnesota led to the death of an officer?
No, I'm saying, though, and you heard me talk to Ben and suggest that...
He's accusing an entire group of people for a random act of violence. That without any facts, he's making very, very strong statements, and that is a reason why people protest.
I think what's really important is getting the narrative right. And the narrative from the movement has always been, we are not a movement about harming police. We are a movement about holding police accountable.
What do we do when people act outside of the expectations of who we want to be together? What does it mean for us to be a group? I think in the pursuit of visibility, we can forget what we're fighting for. The glorious and glamorous part is people in the streets and, you know, protesting and all of that. What's not glamorous is figuring out, okay, how do we be together over the long term? How do we learn how to organize?
One of the major difficulties for a truly leaderless movement is this is very much a mosaic of activism. It's bigger, much bigger than any given, you know, quote-unquote leader, any given quote-unquote organization. And this is the real problem, right?
This is a movement. This is ongoing. We're late, frankly. No matter what we do, we're late. So what's next? Get it together. Get informed. Become it. Become a team.
We all talk about how social media transformed this movement. But now, we've seen young protesters without organized leadership. And so there is a question about where the movement goes from here.
The Black Lives Matter movement in my generation, we have to evolve. We have to make sure it doesn't stop. You know, like how other movements did.
2 years ago, hundreds of protesters gathered in Lower Manhattan to occupy Wall Street. But the Occupy movement had its fair share of problems. From protesters' resistance to clear leadership, the movement seems to have faded away.
We come from a long legacy of protest and struggle. But now we have to galvanize, thousands and thousands of people to fight for reforms in their country and in their government. And so that's why we started Black Lives Matter as a network of 39 chapters around the world. We gon' be all right, we gon' be all right. And so the movement is growing. We gon' be all right, do you hear
me, do you feel me, we gon' be all right. Now, Black Lives Matter is a national organization. Supporters disrupt rallies for Democrats and Republicans alike. The tactic has had an impact. The day after activists interrupted Bernie Sanders, he posted a racial justice platform on his website.
We're now talking about what does it mean to be a movement full of people who are leading and doing the work in different ways, and that there is no one way to organize, there's no one way to be in this work.
What people do here is they repeat the problem. You know? And you're like, I get the problem. We know the problem. I don't need another summit about it. Which is why I'm always focused on the concrete stuff.
Awesome. Thanks
for meeting you.
Yeah, yeah.
So I asked Netta and Brittany and some of the people if they wanted to partner, and we created Campaign Zero. Mapping Police Violence was a statement about here are the facts. It is a powerful tool, and we continue to use it to inform our work. When I think about running for mayor, it's about being in a place to change people's lives today and tomorrow. It's about real, concrete things that can happen at the policy level to structurally end police violence.
And that's what's different about this movement.
We are seeing leaders come forward. And this is because they took social media and made it work for them. Black Twitter is the matrix. Black Twitter popped it off. And because of Twitter, we know who Patrice is, we know who Alicia is, we know who Netta is. This generation is not gonna let them be nameless. And they're doing that.
So for a movement that's not formally funded, that doesn't have a big headquarters in Washington, D.C., or registered lobbyists, it's a lot of momentum. So where does Black Lives Matter go from here? Well, joining us tonight is Alicia Garza. Thank you for joining us tonight.
You had people who had come from regular backgrounds, who were teachers and students, now became these big personalities. They were on the covers of magazines. They were being interviewed by the New York Times. And in doing so, they were leading a whole generation of Black people, and they were representing them as well.
Careful. Everybody ready? Yep. We've got some young people here who are making history as we speak. People like Brittany, who served on our police task force in the wake of Ferguson and has led many of the protests. People like DeRay McKesson, who's done some outstanding work mobilizing in Baltimore around these issues.
It was a real privilege to have the opportunity to be invited to the White House and have a conversation where you are speaking direct truth to power. It is about our children, our community. It is about stay woke. Is that now that you have been exposed, now that you have become aware of issues of police violence in our community, I need you to stay aware. I need you to behave like you're aware, right? I need you to stay woke, get woke, and stay woke.
We can actually change the world if we implement changes on the inside. But also, people need to press from the outside. That pressing from the outside forces things that will otherwise not happen. We need both.
30 African-American football players at the University of Missouri say they're on strike. It is the latest in a series of protests against the school's handling of race relations on campus.
Missouri graduate student Jonathan Butler was so outraged, he went on a hunger strike last week.
How do you feel?
Empowered, ready to eat.
I am resigning as president of the University of Missouri today, and I take full responsibility for the inaction that has occurred.
People were shocked, and I think that was a seminal moment because it was so dramatic, and there's been a culture shift when it comes to athletes speaking out on social issues.
Every time I step outside, I see my dad.
There is no such thing as the arc of history bending towards justice. People do that.
Is it okay to break the law or not? Because the cops are breaking the law left and right. Like, you don't own us anymore. You see, like, either we all have the same inalienable rights or we don't.
An independent investigation that Mr. Gray's death was a homicide has led us to believe that we have probable cause to file criminal charges.
That's why I'm here. That's why the uprising began. That's why we are still rising to this day.
Today, the Department of Justice is filing a lawsuit in federal district court against the city of Ferguson, Missouri, alleging a pattern and practice of law enforcement conduct that violates the First, the Fourth, and the 14th Amendments of the Constitution and federal civil rights laws.
I'm really proud of this generation. It's a revolution in a way. They have used this new tool, and I think Black Lives Matter will define this shift in America. I think we will look at Black Lives Matter like we looked at the civil rights movement.
The Black Lives Matter movement is the most important development in Black life in the last 40 years. And the most important aspect of it is that it's ordinary people fighting this fight, it is something that we have been responsible for getting out onto the streets. And I think the movement is here to stay.
That so many scenes from that take my breath away. I want to thank Black Lives Matter, the movement. I want to thank the people that put that amazing video together. We will put a link up in on YouTube and Facebook. You know, having this moment to find out, for those that did not know, where Black Lives Matter started. The rumors that it was a terrorist group, anti-government, for killing cops, for killing white cops, a hate group. One of the things that I have learned, when there is change to be brought about, that usually the people that do not want change create a whole nother scenario that has nothing to do with the truth. Now, as you can see, of course, there was an uproar, there was some riots. I have to say that I am from St. Louis, Missouri. And when Michael Brown was killed, my brother called me. He still lives there in St. Louis, along with my niece and nephews, and I have cousins that live there. And one of the things that I've known about St. Louis, Missouri for a very long time is that the racial tension is underneath, but it is very present there. That there are places that when I was a kid that my mom would tell me, you can't go there and don't be caught there. Definitely after dark. The police department there, in my own experience as a young teenager there, very rough, almost abusive in certain cases. So, unfortunately, as I recall my conversation with my brother as he was sharing what happened to Michael Brown, there was an outrage from me at first. It was just like, look, don't you go there. You know how it is in St. Louis. I wasn't awake. Knowing that we have been brutalized by police brutality for a very long time, had gotten used to it. And my brother was upset because, of course, he's there in the energy and experiencing it up close and personal. Just a really horrible incident for anyone, no matter what your color, to have to experience. But more than that, as I look back upon myself, not really fully understanding what was at stake and what was taking place. And so in sharing this video with you, wanting you to see that the outrage, the call, the anger, the fear, the absolute fear of being a black man and being stopped by the cops, very real, with the potential to be killed for any reason, not having to justify it, just because. And so I hope that you will do more homework, that you will search more. Black Lives Matter is a movement. It is a waking up of our country to recognize that the problem of racism has not gone away, and it must go away. If we are to become the great nation that we say that we are, racism the system, the systematic system of racism has to be uprooted. And so with that, you see that a lot of our young activists are going through our governmental sources as well, not just on the front line. And I loved what one of the young men said, that we have to have the front line because that does the protest. Most of the protesting that's done by Black Lives Matter is peaceful. The riots that have come are started by a very small, minute people that really don't have anything to do with what's happening. Just little gremlins, I call them. But as you look around the world, Black Lives Matter that is around the world, the protest. I was looking at a couple of protests that they had in Australia, and the government was shutting down the protests. I don't know the laws of Australia, but I know here in the States, we have a legal right to protest. And the people still were protesting. There is a call from the divine that we have to wake up to. We can no longer be a country, a world that allows racism to run, to justify. Is this a hate group? Absolutely not. Nobody wants any police officer to get killed. We honor our police officers, those that honor. But the bad seeds have to be uprooted and moved aside. There are rules and regulations and new stipulations in government to change how we are policed. To see that in Ferguson, they brought in the military, that reminds me of when Rodney King in Los Angeles, and I was very present for that, and the military came in for that. If you've ever been in any kind of environment like that, it is literally a war zone. They shoot and then ask. It's very frightening to be in that type of energy. It's chaotic. And of course, the danger to control a people when the anger and fear of not being recognized as a human being constantly is on the front line. We have to deal with this. So in looking at the young women that have stepped forward, starting with Alicia, people that have called them, have called the Black Lives Movement a terrorist group, not doing any homework, to look at the young women that reached out, and Alicia being the first one that was speaking, it was a love letter to Black people when Trayvon Martin was killed by, he wasn't even a cop. He's as they say, a wannabe. They told him not to, but still Zimmerman was able to get off from killing this young man that did nothing but wear a hoodie in the rain. And so her love letter that she posted on, that she tweeted and on Facebook, that I love you, my Black people, that your life does matter. For me, that the organicness of that, and then for Patrice to put a hashtag in front of it, hashtag Black Lives Matter, that created this underground conversation, this tool of social media that drove this awareness, Black Lives Matter, that young people were able to comment on, were able to attach pictures to, were able to show because of these wonderful little things here. Finally, a reference. And what made it even more so, what made it even more vibrant and more that brought your awareness, because it was on Twitter, it's happening in the moment. It was happening right now. So it wasn't something that happened a day ago. You were actually able to be a part of it happening in this now moment, which was the energy that was driving, as you saw other entertainers, other news people, to go, hey, wait a minute. This is not old news. This is happening right now. And so, understanding that this movement is necessary. This movement is uncomfortable for some of us. And, you know, can you guarantee that there will be no more riots? I hope not. That's not what the movement is about. It's not about riots. And don't get lost on that. This movement is about decency for all human beings, about the equality of all human beings. And recognizing that we, Black people, have been, we've had a target on our back for years. And so, finding out more about Black Lives Matter, finding out how you can support Black Lives Matter, finding out that the young ladies that started this movement, that they have been activists, they have been organizers of different organizations, that this wasn't just an overnight thing. They have been participating in a system that's not working to try to do and move different bills and different things so that we can shift the way we're living. They've been activists. They've been artists speaking out through their art. I highly recommend, I know that Alicia has a book out, The Purpose of Power. I've just started to read it. It's very insightful. It doesn't solely deal with Black Lives Matter, but it deals with our government as well, and the structural changes that we have to make. So from the inside out and from the outside in, these changes must be made. They must come about. I hope tonight that this has caused you to have thought, compassion, and opened up your mind for new possibilities of how you can see. The other group, I've read some of the things that they've done, Ground Zero, powerful group in helping families and also showing, as they showed the map there, Black lives being taken in the places where. A lot of that has to do with it as well. Our places in the South, Midwest, where I'm from, all over. But you see how this Black Lives Matter, it has spun these other organizations to support it, to support. It's easy to look at Fox News and our CNN and some of the other news shows that want to incite you. They want to create fear. And so, yes, they take one person that says, kill the police, and they run that 55,000 times. That's not the truth of what Black Lives Matter is. And as each day passes, they become more and more organized. And people are waking up. That's one of the main things. The young lady says, stay woke. Stay woke to the problem that's at hand. Stay woke that it's going to take each and every one of us. This is not a black issue. This is a people. This is a humanity. This is a world issue. And we all have to stay woke and do our part. And I don't know what your part is, but for me, my part is to bring as much information as I can. And I want to say this to each and every one of you whenever you see this. Be it if you agree or disagree, I'm open. I'm open to discuss. I'm open to have a conversation. I'm open to share your side of it. So if you feel that there's something that's not being said or that you feel your voice isn't being spoken, please reach out to me, Gino@universalspiritcenter.org. I truly believe that one of the ways that we move closer together, that we stay awoke, and that we grow is that we have these conversations, that we explore every possibility, that we allow ourselves to see and experience things from a place that we've never known before, and that's stepping into the unknown. So I'm asking all of you to step into the unknown, to reach for this new possibility. Now, I know it gets tempting to say, you know, things have kind of leveled out, that, you know, we don't need the cops to kill another person for us to keep our focus. Your focus is required now, tomorrow, the day after, until we reach that point. So stay vigilant. Don't let it slide. If the only way you can participate is in buying a t-shirt that says Black Lives Matter, do that. But stay awoke, read, find books that open you up to things that are happening. Doesn't mean that you agree with everything, but at least if you start to explore, then you become aware of other things beyond the way you think. And perhaps in that, you can see another side. You can at least have an opening for another side. And I have to touch this because, you know, there were a few performers and entertainers that said that Black Lives Matter, what is that? That's a piece of junk. That doesn't make any sense. And let's see, how do I say this in the polite way? There are always people that, even though they represent, they say, this skin tone, that forget who they are. Sometimes because they've made a lot of money, they have some success, and there are jokes about it. You know, oh, they think they're white now. And there was a song, and don't take offense, the song was called Mr. Nigger. And the song was simply stating that just because you can ride or fly in first class, just because you have two or three homes, the white man still sees you as Mr. Nigger. And there are those that doing this right now, currently, well-known rapper, some rappers, actors, that lost their way, that did not support Black Lives Matter, that did not support the awareness that we are in a crisis, and said they didn't care. Don't let that sway you, because that's confusion. In the old way, we'd call that an Uncle Tom. You're fine, whomever you are, if you want to be and do whatever, but when you go against your own people to say that this isn't something that's real. You know, one of the things I love that President Obama said when Trayvon Martin was killed, he said, that could be my son. That could be my son. So when you see a black person saying, hey, that Black Lives Matter or racism, there is no such thing as racism. What I love and appreciate everybody. Just be mindful that sometimes people are so asleep that they cannot even see the truth of what's happening to them until, especially if they're a famous person, entertainer, they get in trouble. And then, oh boy, then you see the Mr. Nigger. Because who do they come back to? They come back to their community with their tail between their legs saying, hey, I need your love and support. And we are that community. We are a loving community. So don't be swayed by a few voices that try to say that racism isn't alive, and that racism is a system that's running, and the system must be completely dismantled. We can't do one or two things. This is not about more jobs or moving into a different community. I remember when LeBron James moved to Los Angeles and became a Los Angeles Laker, living in Bel Air, they wrote on his gate, move out, nigga. This was like 6 years ago, maybe five. It's real. And we are really in this thing together. So I ask you to be vigilant in your quest to find information, to seek a higher awareness and appreciation. Alicia Gaza, Patrice Cullors, and Opal Tomey, who are the co-founders of Black Lives Matter, check them out. They all in their own right are activists and have been. They have been participating at a level of government. They have been participating with different organizations to bring about not only social change, but systematic governmental changes as well. And it is a must. To my divine police departments everywhere, police are a beautiful, necessary career that we all appreciate. But the brutality and the blue sense of mind that has ravaged the good cops, that has allowed the bad cops to run, we have to change the system and support our police officers. Support them with new mental ways of consciousness of how to deal with different things. It is a very challenging career to be a police officer in any time and day, and especially now. So I bless you and your families. But I know that we can't continue on the road that we've been going. There has to be systematic change. I want to thank you all for joining tonight. And hopefully you saw something, you heard something that inspired you to a new awareness, to a different possibility. For the first time tonight, I think we are on Instagram. I know we went there. I couldn't find it. I don't know. If not, know that we were, that was our attempt to be on Instagram, and we will. I'll find out what happened. One side says we're streaming there, but I couldn't find it. So there's some things that I'll check out on that. On our YouTube and FaceTube channel and our webpage, thank you for joining tonight or whenever you see. And for our YouTube participants, know that Universal Spirit Center, we are anchored in spiritual tools. And so you have an opportunity to be a part of that. We have new content that's coming out every day. New, beautiful spiritual tools that can help you plug in if your day is out of whack. Heart warmers, heart minutes, I'm sorry, it's called heart minutes, that can help you realign yourself and adjust into a divine presence. Mystical Mondays, this beautiful experience of looking beyond the veil and connecting with your angels. An afternoon with Ernest Holmes to hear the wisdom of the founding teacher for Centers for Spiritual Living. And Golden Nuggets. Golden Nuggets, an opportunity to just get a little drop of wisdom every Friday. So know that we are here for you. Please comment, like or dislike, comment yay, comment no, but help us spread the word. Help us reach more and more people. Because together, we can do anything. I want to thank you all so much for joining me tonight. And no, I believe that this will shift. I don't know if I will see it, but I believe that it will happen. And I believe that each and every person out there that sees this, that you are part of the solution. You are a part of it. So I thank you in advance for all that you do and for what you continue to strive to do. It is now our conscious giving time. Thank you so much for joining.
I am so grateful. I am so
I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so blessed. Now, take your offering, whatever it is. Hold it next to your heart as we take this blessed breath and we give thanks. I give thanks for Universal Spirit Center. I give thanks for each and every person right here and now. For however you tithe or give, be it your time, your finances, your awareness, your insight, your wisdom, I am blessing and giving thanks for however that is. So just join me. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so blessed. And also, let me just let you know what we have coming up for the week of December the 20th. The 21st, we are going to have Winter Solstice. We will be streaming that live to our Facebook, our YouTube, our webpage, and hopefully Instagram as well. Reverend Kevin and Dana Mosser will be here. Along with Linda, I'm not sure if Sarah probably will be here too. So I'm hoping that you'll be here for Winter Solstice. And then Awakening Wednesday, we have a beautiful segment with Sherry Gernad and myself. We will be doing an awakening of Kwanzaa. So we will go through with you the principles of Kwanzaa and expose what the divine culture and how Kwanzaa came forth. And of course, Christmas Eve, Christmas Eve at I think 7 o'clock will be our Christmas Eve service. Looking forward to that. It's going to be spectacular. Christmas morning, once again, Sherry will be here with us, and she will be speaking on the advent of the presence. Oh, it's going to be a fantastic week. So get ready. Get ready to share us with the world, to be a part of it, to come and sing and dance and just recognize the blessings that are overflowing as we collectively will start saying goodbye to 2020 and a hello to 2021. Woo, Oh, I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. Thank you so much. Peace and blessings to you all. And I'll see you next week on Awakening Wednesday.